Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, our guest today is political consultant David Mowrey. Also, the V-Team takes a look at the Supreme Court and gay marriage. Recently, Speaker Mike Hubbard threatened 30 school superintendents. Oh, Mike, are you just too cruel for school? All this and much, much more coming up next on The V. Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team.
Good morning. Glad to be back.
Good to have you back. Not the same without you. This week, the U.S. Supreme Court decided not to hear these same-sex marriage bans. This is a big deal, isn't it, Barron?
It's a big deal, but I think gay marriage is a 50-state inevitable reality in the near future anyway. I don't think the Supreme Court was going to stop that by hearing these. As a conservative, I don't see the word marriage in the federal constitution. I don't think it's a federal issue. So them pushing it to the side and saying we're not going to hear it, I don't think is a concerning issue as far as I'm concerned as a Republican.
What does that mean for Alabama?
It doesn't mean anything right now.
Right.
The decision to not accept the cases applied to the 4th, 7th, and 10th circuits. Alabama's part of the 11th circuit. We don't have a case that is pending before the 11th circuit just yet. There are two that I understand have been filed and are pending in federal district court in Birmingham and Montgomery, but there's nothing that would have been pending for the decision out of the Supreme Court to actually have any effect on. But I think I'm like Barron. I think it's inevitable because we're now at, 30 states that recognize same-sex unions?
I mean, this is not a political winner here.
No, it's not. It's going to be a political issue in the presidential election cycle, I would say, in 2016.
It's the same argument we had over birth control and abortion right. 50, 60 years ago. A few states had it. Other states didn't want to. They went to the Supreme Court. It became a 50-state reality. Gay marriage is trending down the same path and for the same reasons. And I don't think you can say you can have birth control and an abortion, but you can't have gay marriage. I mean, it's all or nothing.
And we've talked about this before on the show. It's really a generational issue.
Right.
The polls that have looked at it say if you're under 50, folks generally don't care and don't oppose it. It's the folks that are about 55 and up that really have strong opinions opposing the recognition of these marriages.
And the thing is, it's just another emotional political issue, like Barron mentioned, between abortion and life and gay marriage and that sort of thing. It's just, it'll be a national issue.
Well, and it looks, I agree, it's inevitable, it's here, it's going to stay, it's going to be a part of our life.
The answer to this, if conservatives really want to push their issue forward, you say, in the state of Alabama, there will be no benefits whatsoever attached to marriage. No tax benefits, no insurance benefits. You could do it from the federal level, outlaw employers being able to offer family coverage, insurance. If you really want to push back against it, that's the way to do it and say there will be no governmental recognition of marriage at any level for any reason. Everyone can put one beneficiary on file at any given time, and there's your answer.
I think Barron's hair just caught on fire. That's never going to happen.
Well, it may never happen, but
that
would be a viable solution.
I'm a conservative with you. But that's just not going to happen. We're in the 2014 cycle, and, you know.
It makes too much sense for it to happen.
Right. Well, and talking about people who make sense and don't make sense, the chairman of the ALGOP, the Republican Party here in Alabama, Bill Armistead, made an astounding statement this week.
No, it was embarrassing.
was that sarcasm, as my daughter would say?
Was that sarcasm?
Yeah,
what he said was, a vote for any Democrat is a vote for Obama and his agenda. We are still yet to see Obama on any ballot.
Because here's the deal. In Alabama, the Obama politics, the extreme liberal politics, are very unpopular. I don't think that Democrats in Alabama identify necessarily with what people call the Obama politics. Right. And so the only way to defeat them on a local level, on an issue level, is to tie them to what folks consider the more liberal, radical agenda.
Well, you know, as a Republican, it's very frustrating because we saw this issue over and over again in the primary, and people would not run on issues, and the people of this state deserve to know issues. And it's a little bit embarrassing that the chairman would do something like this because he's not here in our state. He's not running. And there's a lot of good people, whether they're independents, Democrats, or Republicans.
You may not have seen Obama on a ballot in Alabama during the primary season, but he was on plenty, or his picture was on plenty.
Oh, he was on every TV. Yeah, he inundated every TV station from Huntsville to Mobile.
It's insulting. Bill Armistead has gone down to the theater of the absurd. He's a blubbering idiot. If you vote for a Democratic sheriff's candidate in Crenshaw County, you are not voting for Barack Obama. For him to suggest so is ridiculous and absurd. It shows contempt for the average voter and that he looks at them as stupid morons that he can control with these stupid things.
Well, and one of the things, I don't want to go too far down this road, but it's almost like the racist politics of the early 60s.
It's what they call the dog whistle politics. Yeah, right. It's a euphemism for something else.
But, a third of all Alabamans go down, particularly in a general election, at least a third, and split their votes. Like you're saying, on a county level, you can go back and split your votes. So, let people have a voice and vote. I mean, I think we should throw out the window what he said.
Armistead really needs to go home.
He's an idiot. He's an idiot.
Okay,
one of the things that we need to talk about here
more important
is we were given a poll this week, actually a leaked poll from a very reputable firm that shows Attorney General Luther Strange in a virtual dead heat with contender Joe Hubbard. Joe Hubbard might have a serious chance, according to this poll, of becoming the next Attorney General, even though he's a Democrat, Claire.
And I think that's exactly why Armistead is making these kind of crazy accusations. Yeah, I mean, I think it's very interesting. This race has been we've all said this has been this is the most high-profile race statewide right now, because you've got a sitting attorney general who's been lagging behind in the polls since day one, or really since June or July.
Right.
And Joe Hubbard, a young Democrat, but has a lot of name ID. His grandfather was a U.S. senator, and he's gone out there and really been campaigning on the issues and really about crime, because, people think of their attorney general as somebody who fights crime.
You've got some things on that poll.
I do. And here's what, if I were advising the Strange campaign, there are three things that would concern me. Number one, the poll is by Hickman Analytics. They're one of the top polling firms in the country. They know Southern politics. They know these issues. They know Alabama. And so to have a polling firm like this tell you that there's a dead heat would be very concerning to me. Second, it is truly a dead heat. Out of the people who say they will definitely vote, Hubbard and Strange are polling 45% apiece. The third thing that would concern me is that Attorney General Strange has a 25% higher name recognition than Joe Hubbard, and yet they're in a dead heat. And so that tells me that everything, and there's also a 7-point gain since June of this year. That tells me that everything that Joe Hubbard is doing is as effective with the folks who are answering these polls.
We got to leave it right there. But can he win?
Yes.
Can Joe Hubbard win? What do you think? Think he can win?
I think it's very close. I think he can. It all depends on voter turnout when you got a dead heat like
that.
What
do you think?
I think he's a real contender.
I think he's a contender, too. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. We'll be right back with our guest, David Mowrey, a political consultant.
The V is sponsored by Spot On Strategies Group.
I teach. I touch the future. I am AEA.
I keep the school clean every day for your children. I am AEA.
Congratulations on your scholarship. I help children make choices for college and careers. I am AEA.
We are AEA.
It's time to take a road trip.
In Alabama, the road and the restaurants are calling. We've elevated barbecue to an art form, a meat masterpiece. Fine dining your thing? National awards are putting us on the map.
Because everything's fresh and local.
And if you like your dinner with a view, well, you can't beat this. Alabama has a road trip with your name on it.
Which one you gonna take?
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Our guest today is David Mowrey, political consultant in the state of Alabama. Welcome, David.
Thanks for having me.
You have run a lot of campaigns. You advise some of our top leadership in the state. How did you come to want to do this type of work?
Well, you know, like anybody, it's sort of... I didn't start out wanting to do this. I was actually a journalism major in college, straight journalism, wanted to run a paper. But as you know, that's all online these days and
right.
That type of thing. And short, I got a job with a company called Edelman in Washington, D.C. They're a huge public relations firm. There's a guy who's about my age, and he had a corner office, you know, on K Street. And I said, you know, how do I become you? And he said, it's really simple. You either go to the Hill or you go to campaigns. And, you know, and you know, you work your way up, and then, you know, you can be somebody. I said, okay, that makes sense. And right about that time, September 11th happened, and nobody was getting hired on the Hill.
Right.
So I knew a woman who worked for Representative John Lewis, and I said, I'm from Georgia. Audience probably doesn't know that, but I said, you know, hey, you know, what do you think? And she said, look, you're not gonna find a Hill job. Call this guy. This won't stop them at all. And I'm kind of like, okay, you know, like who lives in a business that September 11th won't stop them?
Right.
And political fundraising.
Ah.
And so I called a guy, and he's, you know, they interviewed me. We liked each other. And my eventual boss called me and said, do you want to go to Harrisburg or Montgomery? And I figured Montgomery's closer to Atlanta and all that. So sure. I came down here to work for Governor Siegelman's reelection in 2001. And then I sort of made my way from there, you know, you kind of do low-level stuff. You know, you're in a back room doing research and all that. And then I did a big race in Georgia as the finance director. And then I ended up going to Mobile and working for John Tyson, who was the DA at the time in 2004. And we raised a lot of money. And he ran for AG in 2006. And he lost. But I ended up meeting my now wife and moving to Montgomery. And then right about the time that I was like, you know, I think I'm going to have to pull up stakes, I got offered the Bobby Bright job.
Ah.
And when he was the mayor and he ran for Congress
right,
in 2008.
Right.
And that kind of put me on the map. That was where people were like, oh, this guy, you know, he isn't just, you know, some giant hanging out here, you know, lurking around us. He actually knows what he's talking about. And
you were integral to Todd Strains becoming mayor of Montgomery.
So after Bright won, the mayor's was vacant. And then Todd hired me basically based on the job that I did there. We actually had our celebration, our election night party here, because
oh.
He used to be the commerce director.
Right, right.
When it was ADO, I guess. And then from there, I started my own business and just sort of, you know, you learn when you're coming up, you learn like, you just learn the different aspects of campaigns. You see how they're done right, you see how they're done wrong, you see how people spend money right, how they deal with candidates right. And I've just sort of adapted all those lessons into, you know, into my business.
One of the things that you do that not a lot of people do is you don't play the partisan game. You work with Democrats, Republicans, independents, whoever.
My joke is I'm a member of the Green Party, because if you got the green, I'll come to your party.
Well, that's a good party to be in.
Not the Green Party to be, you know.
Right, the where the money
yeah,
is.
That's right. You know. And that comes about, I think, from several things. I'm an Army brat, and so it's sort of like you owe your allegiance to the people that are in charge of you. Not to say that you don't question them, but you know what I mean.
Yeah,
it's sure. Just sort of, it's mission, it's the, what's the mission?
Right.
And then Todd Strange hiring me had a lot to do with that, and several other people after that. My first two clients were Senator Brubaker and Senator Beasley.
Ah, okay.
And I think, you know, and people, a lot of times, people do ask me this question, and I say, you know, I have two criteria. Number one, are you doing this because it's what you believe, or because you think it's an issue you can demagogue on?
Right.
If you believe it, then who am I to judge your beliefs? That's sort of the way that I think
right.
about it. And then, are you a crook?
Right.
And I just like, you know, if you got your hand in the till, I'm not going to work for you. And that's just, you know, I don't think anybody that I've worked for there's ever been a question of that. And those are really, and then third, it's a small state. I mean, do I like you? You know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right, right.
A lot of it has to do with that. You get into a situation where you don't like the candidate and the candidate doesn't like you. It's just, it's not fair to them. It's not fair to me. And it's, you know, really not fair to the public because you end up running bad campaigns. So.
Well, you know, you've had a lot of success with running on both sides. I mean, I don't know how extreme Brubaker and Beasley are. I like them both. But they are coming with different philosophies, certainly. What do you think, is there a race that's statewide right now that's of interest to you as a spectator?
Yeah, you know, I think, well, everybody sort of is seeing what's going to happen in the governor's race. I think that all available polling is just that's just not within reach.
Right.
And then the, you know, the lieutenant governor's race, just there's a monetary advantage and a name ID advantage. The attorney general's race looks very interesting to everybody. Everywhere that I go, either in Montgomery or around the state, that's the one that people want to know about.
Right,
hey, is this race real? And obviously, I haven't seen internal polling, but I do hear from people that have, or claim that they have. You know, who knows? And everybody seems to think that it's neck and neck. From what I hear, the attorney general has really hurt himself with his base. And is, you know, and is having to do a lot. If you see their advertising, a lot of that has to be like, a lot of the what they're doing is he's driving to his base, and it's 4 weeks from the election. And
right,
you know, I'd be worried if I was having to shore up my base 4 weeks from an election.
Sure. What would be your advice to both candidates if they ask you, or do you give out free advice?
That's a good point. No, I'm not in the business of giving out free advice, but I think both of them are in a position where they need to be doing whatever it is that their polling shows works. They need to be doing more of it. I think that they need to be, I see the Hubbard ad sometimes. I haven't seen a Luther Strange ad in Montgomery, and somebody has, I heard that they're not on in Montgomery, which means that's a money thing. So raise more money.
Right.
And, you know, and really make it happen. And then the second thing would be, you know, don't sleep on, you know, digital ads. Don't sleep on all the new media stuff that guys like me can do,
right,
to get you into that segment of people that just don't watch TV. I mean,
we've got about 30 seconds, and I know you advise candidates as well. What's the most important thing you ever tell a candidate to do? What would that be? Is there one certain thing that you do?
Be yourself. I don't mean that like, be yourself in terms of don't go against the grain of who you are,
right,
trying to sell something that you're not, because if you do, people will see through that.
Right.
You have to put whatever is best about you in the frame and make that what people remember about you. And it doesn't matter if you fit some stereotype of an Alabama candidate who carries a gun or drives a NASCAR or whatever. It has to do with who you are and what you're going to do for them.
Well, you've been a good friend to us.
Thanks, sir.
We appreciate your service.
It's great to see you.
All right. Thank you
appreciate
for being on the show.
Thank you.
Our guest today has been David Mowrey, political consultant here in Alabama. You're watching The V. We'll be right back with The V Team.
The V is sponsored by MediaWorks Communications Video Production Services for all your video production needs.
I teach. I touch the future. I am AEA.
I keep the school clean every day for your children. I am AEA.
Congratulations on your scholarship. I help children make choices for college and careers. I am AEA.
We are AEA.
Welcome to Alabama's newest entertainment destination, Wind Creek Wetumpka, the perfect escape for date night, a getaway with your friends, or a relaxing poolside cocktail. Whether it's a day trip to enjoy the best steak in Alabama or a romantic weekend, the finest southern hospitality is just a short drive away. Wind Creek Wetumpka, find your winning moment.
The preventing wildfires. That's all Smokey wants for his 70th birthday.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Jack, it's nice to have you this Sunday.
Thank you. Glad to be back.
It's so good to be with you again, though, too.
Of course,
Claire. I missed
Claire
you last week.
Jack does the best impression.
He does do, well, it's an impression. Jack, you do make an impression.
I don't know. Yeah, you ought to see the seat after I get up.
Oh, no. Speaking of guys who make impressions, Barrymore, Representative Barrymore, he is accused of lying to a grand jury, of perjury, making false statements. His trial is coming up. I'd almost bet that they're out there trying to cut a deal. But this week, his defense team admitted that these tapes that Josh Pipkin recorded are fair and should be admitted into the trial. Barron, what does this mean?
Well, I mean, it just means that they're stating the obvious, that these will be played in front of a jury. I can't imagine a scenario in which Barrymore doesn't get convicted of a felony. And so that means to me the state will be rid of Barrymore once and for all. He should have stepped aside with dignity when he knew he'd gotten caught. He never should have lobbed the threats against a political opponent in the first place. And sayonara. I'm glad to see him go.
You're not real fond of Barrymore.
I'm not very fond of Barrymore at all. And I've heard the tapes, and they're credible threats. And whether or not he delivered them on behalf of Mike Hubbard or not, I suspect he did. It's what it sounds like. He needs to go. I agree with Barron. He should have stepped aside, as you say, with dignity. But he won't dig his heels in, and he's going to pay the price.
I mean, I don't think a guy like Hart is going to show a whole lot of mercy to a guy that's put them through the ringer like this. What do
that's
you
right.
think?
I agree with you. I just concur on what they said. He should have stepped aside with dignity. But as we know, he is one of the speaker's lieutenants. So he had to stand firm and, you know, toe the party line for him and do what was right. But he's going to pay the price personally and for his family as well.
I mean, he's got a
which
wife.
Is sad. And children, yeah.
And children.
I mean that's just greed.
I mean, while he may be Jethro Bodine in a suit, he does have a family.
Yeah, and I've met his wife. She's really nice.
She's very nice.
Heather, I think, is her name. She's great. Yeah.
Two cute children, but, you know, you get into this, everybody becomes involved in politics.
Or four cute children, but does cut his family in half.
Oh,
that's all right.
I'm sorry.
Does he get a felony plea deal, do you think?
I think he would take a felony plea deal. I think the rumors are that his wife is really pushing him to take a deal if one is offered.
Well, that felony thing, that's some serious business, you know. I mean,
yeah.
And he's had state contracts.
It sounds like he went in there and they said, did you threaten Josh Pipkin? And he said no. And they said, well, here's the tape that you did. And
that's pretty much what it sounds like.
I think another thing, this just leads to more and more and more that what's going on in Lee County is for real and it's serious because you do have Barrymore and you do have Greg Wren and all these other things looming out there.
And they're saying the same thing, Hubbard,
yeah,
Hubbard.
That's the common link.
Hubbard this week, Speaker Hubbard, not this week, but earlier in September, was at a meeting of school administrators, the board meeting of school administrators. It got a little heated. He got angry, I hear. It was reported.
Shocking.
And he threatened Dr. D. Fowler, who is the superintendent of Madison Schools, and also 30 other superintendents who filed an amicus brief in support of the unconstitutional ruling made by Judge Reese. I mean, this is a pretty wild thing. Can you imagine him threatening somebody, Claire?
Well, I absolutely can. I've been a victim of that. But, I mean, you know, this just shows, I think, everybody that he's kind of losing a little bit to do that to that many superintendents.
I mean, I got text messages within seconds of that threat. I mean, what do you make of it?
Claire's right
what,
on. He's
what,
losing.
What did he say in the threat?
You'll be sorry you ever signed on to this lawsuit.
Yeah.
He's losing his mind. He's losing his control. I saw a picture of him on Facebook. It looks like he gained 80 pounds. He doesn't look healthy. He's lashing out at people in public. His threats are increasing, not decreasing under the spotlight. He's not being very disciplined, which is very unusual for him.
He's stressed. Yeah. He's under a lot of pressure because he knows he's done wrong, and he's trying to figure out how to get out of this.
Well, that felon's euphoria is gone, hasn't it, Jack?
I think so. I don't have much use for him or faith in him. So,
well, this is a serious. If any of these crimes he committed, any of them, they are serious felony offenses. And he will go to jail for a
Well, he supposedly told a Republican caucus meeting not to hire Barron and me for the political services.
Well, we've all been threatened by him,
yeah.
haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
Don't hire y'all.
Yeah.
Don't do business with her.
Right.
and surely don't do business with you guys.
Well, once he's gone, we'll all be just fine.
Well, you know, the when I realized that we were in trouble is when somebody that worked for Alpha told another individual, don't get too close to those Brits. They're on the speaker's hit list. Well, Sid, and I want to go to something else, and I think this is important. You guys have a radio show. Tell them how to get to the radio show.
93.1 FM WACV in Montgomery. It's from 9 to noon, Monday through Friday. You can listen on the TuneIn radio app, newstalk931.com. It's a lot of fun. It's conversational. It's not attack radio. It's not.
We're a lot nicer on there than we are here.
We are, actually.
Well, you got more time. One of the things that y'all brought up on the show, and we reported it as well, is that Speaker Hubbard this week went to Jackson Hole, Wyoming, to attend an ethics and leadership conference where he is a panelist. I mean, is this not gut-wrenching irony?
I think the guy on the panel is the indicted Speaker Pro Tem in Indiana.
Right? The chair of the event hosting organization is being run out of his own party in Indiana for underhanded deals he was cutting.
The only other person they need is the Speaker of the House in South Carolina,
South Carolina.
Was recently indicted. Birds of a feather.
Locked together.
Well, I mean, break that story down in Indiana for
us. In Indiana, there's the Speaker Pro Tem, not the Speaker of the House, but the appointed by the Speaker of the House Pro Tem, has a nursing home business. Behind the scenes, he was working to defeat legislation that would harm his personal business. The Speaker of the House found out about it, removed him from leadership, encouraged him not to run, tried to get him removed from the ballot. They're doing it right in Indiana. In Alabama, we're coddling and encouraging the thuggery.
Well, you know,
because he threatens people, and there are a lot of people out there that are still very nervous and still threaten a lot of
these.
Why
do lobbyists keep giving to his
PAC? Well, it's a lot of the big business corporations. Well, you got a lot of the very big business people still lined up with him till the shoe falls, because not only do you have the speaker, you have a very large gentleman that was a former governor that's very much connected with him and a lot of business dealings.
Yeah,
and it's nerve-wracking. People are frightened of both of these men.
Bob Riley and Hubbard have run this state into the ground. Them and their bootlicking sycophants. Is that how you pronounce that?
Sycophants.
I like that better. Well, it's interesting. I feel that the day of reckoning is right around the corner, and I think that Hubbard and maybe even Riley and a bunch of these guys are going to feel the swift sword of justice. We're going to have to leave it right there. You've been watching The Voice of Alabama Politics. You can catch us every day at alreporter.com and every week on Sunday on your ABC affiliates throughout the state. Thanks for watching. Have a good Sunday.